Greetings in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We are continuing in our studies from Romans 12, verses 9 to 21, on the believer's response to other people in the context of Christian behavior. In this study, we will be looking at verses 14 and 15. Let me read those verses. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. As we go through these verses, it is very evident that Christian behavior is exhibited most commonly in ordinary practical living and not just when we come to the assembly. The great doctrines of chapters 1 to 11 should be translated into the daily life of the believer. This is so important because the glory of God is exhibited in the great salvation He has provided. We bring it into disrepute by a way of life that does not match with it. People would rather see how we live out this great salvation than what we say about it. It was the life of the Christians of the early church and right through the centuries that had the greatest impact in the spreading of the gospel. Paul instructed Timothy in 1 Timothy 4 and verse 16, keep a close watch on yourself and on the teaching. Very often we do not enjoy the benefits of this great salvation because we are not ready to obey the straightforward instructions of Scripture. Many times we look for some blessing or special experience when it can be actually found by simple obedience. The Lord Jesus told the disciples, if you know these things, blessed or happy are you if you do them. The apostle points us in verse 14 to a Christian behavior that really tests the depth of our Christian maturity. It is in the context of our reaction to the harmful things that others do to us. The trustworthiness of Scripture is that it gives us a realistic picture of life. It does not put us in an imaginary world where it says that when you come to Christ, you will not have any problems. An imaginary world where you will be rich and successful, have all your wants met, and where you feel good about yourself. The Lord Jesus told His disciples, in the world you will have tribulation. Paul also said the same thing to the new disciples in the cities where he took the gospel. In Acts 14 and verse 22, He taught them, through many tribulations, we must enter the kingdom of God. There is a certainty of believers facing persecution, which may be of different kinds and not just physical. All who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. 2 Timothy 3 and verse 12. Such persecution can come from both outside the church and also within the church. Persecution can be in many forms: intellectual, emotional, sometimes behind the back, and so on. What is to be our reaction? It is to be totally opposite to what we would do naturally. The apostle says, "Bless those who persecute you." The word bless is literally, speak them good, pray for them, ask God to deal with them for their good, send down a blessing, and not for their destruction. That is the meaning of what is stated in the negative, do not curse. Our attitude to persecution must be positive. Desire the good of those who persecute us. The Christian is a new man and has to live an entirely new life. He is the only man who can live the life depicted here. The natural man is entirely incapable of living such a life. The only way a Christian can react in this way is to look at his master and to look at himself. The first place that is essential to look at is the Lord Jesus and how he reacted. Peter writes, "When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly." 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 23. The second place to look at is the way God has dealt with us. We were the enemies of God, and he could have dealt with us very severely. We read of Saul that he was breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. But on the road to Damascus, he heard the voice of the Lord Jesus, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" After his remarkable conversion, Paul could write years later, "I received mercy. The grace of our Lord overflowed for me." Both the Lord Jesus on the cross and Stephen, when he was being stoned, said magnificent words of forgiveness. The Lord Jesus said, "Father, forgive them." And Stephen, he said, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." In verse 15, the apostle deals with our reaction to the things which happen in the lives of others. He says, "Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep." Here again we see a reaction which is opposite to our natural tendency. Naturally, we are jealous when others rejoice and to pass by when they mourn. The apostle puts rejoicing before weeping to probably give it an emphasis. It is more difficult to rejoice with those who rejoice than to weep with those who weep. It is only the very hard-hearted who will not be touched by a person weeping. Now, the person who is rejoicing is because he has got or done something which makes him feel a sense of achievement. But this stirs up in our old nature the element of competition. The ultimate problem with all of mankind, including the most learned people, is the problem of envy and jealousy. It started right in the beginning with Cain, who was jealous of Abel, just because God looked with favor on him and his offering. One way to face this problem as a believer is to be indifferent to the joys and sorrows of others. But that is the highest the natural man can attain, at least to the extent of not showing it. But that is negative and not enough for a believer. Here the apostle is saying that we are really to be pleased with the success of others. Only a believer who is born again of water and the Spirit can reach such a level. It is the deliverance from our old self that can enable us to rejoice with those who rejoice. The fourth verse of the song, "How I Praise Thee, Precious Savior," brings out this thought well. It goes like this. It says, "Witnessing thy power to save me, setting free from self and sin, thou hast bought me to possess me. In thy fullness, Lord, come in." To weep with those who weep does not need much elaboration. It is something more natural to us. The smallest verse in the Bible says, Jesus wept. He shared in the sorrow of Mary and Martha. God's way for us is to enter into the joys and sorrows of those around us. Let me close with the words of what was said at the beginning of the chapter. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. May God bless this study to our hearts, and may His name be glorified.